Hey guys, welcome to the fourth part of the violin introduction. Previously, in part 3, we have discussed about the violin's tuning and bows. I hope you have learned a lot from it. If you have not seen the previous video, then you can catch up with it by clicking the link in description. Here in today's video, we will continue the introduction with its playing techniques. Therefore, before we begin, if you are new to this channel and like the content what we post, then you should go and hit the subscribe button and push the bell icon so that you will not miss these kind of videos when we upload them. Let's begin. The violin is played either seated or standing up. Solo players, whether playing alone, with a piano or with an orchestra, play mostly standing up unless prevented by a physical disability, such as in the case of Itzhak Perlman. While in the orchestra and in chamber music, it is usually played seated. In the 2000 and 2010s, some orchestra performing Baroque music, such as the Freiburg Baroque Orchestra, have had all of their violins and violas, solo and ensembles perform standing up. The standard way of holding the violin is with the left side of the jaw resting on the chin rest of the violin and supported by the left shoulder, often assisted by a shoulder rest or a sponge and an elastic band for younger players who struggle with shoulder rests. The jaw and the shoulders must hold the violin firmly enough to allow it to remain stable when the left hand goes from a high position. A high pitched note far up on the fingerboard to a low one nearer to the peg box. In the Indian posture, the stability of the violin is guaranteed by its scroll resting on the side of the foot. While teachers point out the vital importance of good posture, both for the sake of the quality of the playing and to reduce the chances of repetitive strain injury, advice as to what good posture is and how to achieve it differs in details. However, all insists on the importance of a natural, relaxed position without tension or rigidity. Things which are almost universally recommended is keeping the left wrist straight or very nearly so to allow the fingers of the left hand to move freely and to reduce the chance of injury, and keeping either shoulder in a natural relaxed position and avoiding raising either of them in an exaggerated manner. This, like any other unwarranted tension, would limit freedom of motion and increase the risk of injury. Hunching can hamper good playing because it throws the body off balance and makes the shoulders rise. Another sign that comes from unhealthy tension is pain in the left hand, which indicates too much pressure when holding the violin. Well, this was all about the posture. Now let's see the left hand and the pitch production of it. First, position fingerings. Note that this diagram only shows the first position notes. There are notes of higher pitch beyond those indicated. The left hand determines the sound length of the string and thus the pitch of the string by stopping it, pressing it against the fingerboard with the fingertips, producing different pitches. As the violin has no frets to stop the strings, as is usual with the guitar, the player must know how exactly where to place the fingers on the strings to play with good intonation or tuning. Beginning violinists play open strings and the lowest position, nearest to the nut. Students often start with relatively easy keys, such as A major and G major. Students are taught scales and simple melodies. Through practice of scales and arps and ear training, the violinist's left hand eventually finds the notes intuitively by muscle memory. Beginners sometimes rely on tapes placed on the fingerboards for proper left hand finger placement. but usually abandon the tips quickly as they advance. Another commonly used marking technique used dots of white out on the fingerboard, which wear off in a few weeks of regular practice. This practice, unfortunately, is used sometimes in lieu of adequate ear training, guiding the placement of fingers by eye and not by ear. Especially in the early stages of learning to play, the so-called ringing tones are useful. There are 9 such notes in first position where a stop note sounds a unison or octave with another open string, causing it to resonate sympathetically. Students often use these ringing tones to check the intonation of the stopped note by seeing if it is harmonious with the open string. For example, when playing the stop pitch A on a G string, the violinist could play the open D string at the same time to check the intonation of the stopped A. If the A is in tune, the A and the open D string should produce a harmonious perfect fourth. Violins are tuned in perfect fifths, like all the orchestral strings, violin, viola, cello, except the double bass, which is tuned in perfect fourth. Each subsequent note is stopped at a pitch and player perceives as the most harmonious when unaccompanied. A violinist does not play consistently in either the tempered or the natural, just scale, but tends on the whole to conform the Pythagorean scale. When violinists are playing a string quartet or a string orchestra, the strings typically sweeten their tuning to suit the key they are playing in. When playing with an instrument tuned to equal temperament, such as a piano, skilled violinists adjust their tuning to match the equal temperament of the piano to avoid discordant notes. The fingers are conventionally number 1 index through 4 little finger in music notation, such as sheet music and etude books. Especially in instructional editions of violin music, number over the notes may indicate which finger to use, with 0 or O indicating an open string. Now let's see the positions. The placement of the left hand on the fingerboard is characterized by positions. First position, where most beginners start, although some methods start in third position, is the most commonly used position in string music. Music composed for beginning youth orchestras is often mostly in first position. The lowest note available in this position is standard tuning is an open G. The highest note in the first position is played with the fourth finger on the E string sounding a B. Moving the hand up the neck so the first finger takes the place of the second finger brings the player into second position. Letting the first finger take the first position place of the third finger brings the player to the third position, and so on. A change of positions when it is associated movement of the hand is referred to as a shift, and effective shifting maintaining accurate intonation and a smooth legato connected sound is a key element of technique at all levels. Often a guide finger is used. The last finger to play a note in the old position continuously lightly touches the string during the course of the shift to an end up on its correct place in the new position. In elementary shifting exercises, the guide finger is often voiced while it glides up and down the string, so the players can establish by ear whether they are landing in the correct place. However, outside of these exercises, it should rarely be audible unless the performer is consciously applying a portamento effect for expressive reasons. In the course of a shift in low position, the thumb of the left hand moves up or down the neck of the instrument as to remain in the same position relative to the fingers, though the movement of the thumb may occur slightly before or slightly after the movement of fingers. In such positions, the thumb is often thought of as an anchor whose location defines what position the player is in. In very high positions, the thumb is unable to move with the fingers as the body of the instrument gets in the way. Instead, the thumb works around the neck of the instrument to sit at a point at which the neck meets the right bout of the body and remains there while the finger moves between the high positions. A note played outside the normal compass of a position without any shift is referred to as an extension. For instance, in third position on an A string, the hand naturally sits with the first finger on accidental D and the fourth on either accidental G or G sharp. Stretching the first finger back down to C sharp or the fourth finger up to an accidental A forms an extension. Extensions are commonly used where one or two notes are slightly out of an otherwise solid position and give them the benefit of being less intrusive than a shift or a string crossing. The lowest position on the violin is referred to as half position. In this position, the first finger is on a low first position note, example B flat on a A string, and the fourth finger is in a downward extension from its regular position, that is, for example, accidental D on a A string, with the other two fingers placed in between as required. As the position of a thumb is typically the same in half position as in first position, it is better taught as a backward extension of the whole hand than a genuine position. The upper limit of the violin's range is largely determined by the skill of the player, who may easily play more than 2 octaves on a single string or 4 octaves on an instrument as a whole. Position names are mostly used for the lower position and in method books and etudes. For this reason, it is common to hear references to anything higher than 7th position. The highest position, practically speaking, is the 13th position. Very high positions are a particular technical challenge for two reasons. Firstly, the difference in location of different notes become much narrower in high position, making the notes more challenging to locate and in some cases to distinguish by ear. Secondly, the much shorter sounding length of the string is in very high position is a challenge for the right arm and bow in sounding the instrument effectively. The finer and more expensive an instrument, the better able it is to sustain good tone right to the top of the fingerboard at a highest pitches on the E string. All notes except those below the open D can be played on more than one string. This is a standard design feature of a string instrument. However, it differs from the piano, which has only one location for each of its 88 notes. For instance, the note of open A on the violin can be played as the open A or on the D string in the first to fourth position or even on the G string very high up in the 6th to 9th positions. Each string has a different tone quality because of the different weights, thickness of the string and because of the resonance of other open strings. For instance, the G string is often regarded as having a very full, sonorous sound, which is particularly appropriate to late romantic music. This is often indicated in the music by marking, for example, sol G or 4, a Roman numeral indicating to play the fourth string. By convention, the strings are numbered from thinnest to highest pitch 1 to the lowest pitch 4. Even without an explicit instruction in the score, an advanced violinist can or will use his or her discretion in artistic sensibility to select which string to play specific notes or passages. Now let's see the open strings. If a string is bowed or plucked without any finger stopping it, it is said to be an open string. This gives a different sound from a stopped string, since the string vibrates more freely at the nut than under a finger. Further, it is impossible to use vibrato fully on an open string, though a partial effect can be achieved by stopping a note an octave up on an adjacent string and vibrating that, which introduces an element of vibrato into the overtones. In the classical tradition, violinists will often use a string crossing or shift of position to allow them to avoid the change of timbre introduced by an open string unless indicated by the composer. This is particularly true for the open E, which is often regarded as having a harsh sound. However, there is also situations where an open string may be specifically chosen for an artistic effect. This is seen in classical music, which is imitating the drone of an organ. J.S. Bach, in his Partita in E for solo violin, achieved this. Fiddling, example, hold on. Or where taking steps to avoid the open string is musically inappropriate. For instance, in Baroque music, where shifting position was less common. In quick passages of scales or arcs, an open E string may simply be used for convenience if the notes does not have the time to ring and develop a harsh timbre. In folk music, fiddling and other traditional music genres, open strings are commonly used in their resonant timbre. Playing an open string simultaneously with a stop note on an adjacent string produces a bagpipe-like drone, often used by composers in imitation of folk music. Sometimes the two notes are identical, for instance playing a fingerboard A on the D string against the open A string, giving a ringing sort of fiddling sound. Playing an open string simultaneously with an identical stop note can also be called for when more volume is required, especially in orchestral playing. Some classical violin parts have notes for which the composer requests the violinist to play an open string because of the specific sonority created by an open string. Double stopping is when two separate strings are stopped by the fingers and both simultaneously producing a 6th, 3rd, 5th, etc. Double stops can be indicated in any position, though the widest interval that can be double stopped in one position is an octave, with the first finger on the lower string and the fourth finger on the higher string. Nonetheless, intervals of 10th or even more are sometimes required to be double stopped in advanced playing, resulting in a stretched left hand position with the fingers extended. The term double stop is often used to encompass sounding an open string alongside a finger note as well, even though only one finger stop in the string. Where three or four more simultaneous notes are written, the violinist will typically split the chord, choosing the lower one or two notes to play first before promptly continuing onto the upper one or two notes. A triple stop with three simultaneous notes is possible in some circumstances. The bow will not naturally strike three strings at once, but if there is sufficient bow speed and pressure when the violinist breaks a three-note chord, the bow hair can be bent temporarily so all three can sound. This is accomplished with heavy stroke, typically quite near the frog and quite loud. Double stops in orchestra are occasionally marked DVC and divided between the players, and half of the musicians playing the lower notes and the other half playing the higher notes. Playing double stops is common when the violin play accompaniment and other instrument or section plays melodically. In some genres of historically informed performances, usually of Baroque music and earlier, neither split chord nor triple stop chords are thought to be appropriate, and violinists will arp all chords and even the appear to be regular double stops, playing all or most notes individually as if they had been written as a slurred figure. In some musical styles, a sustained open string drone can be played during a passage mainly written on an adjacent string to provide a basic accompaniment. This is more often seen in folk traditions than in classical music. However, with the development of modern violins, triple stopping came more naturally due to the bridge being less curved. Now let's see vibrato. Petrovich Bissin was an instructor of vibrato method on the violin and published a book titled Cultivation of the Violin Vibrato Tone. Vibrato is a technique of the left hand and arm in which the pitch of a note varies subtly in a pulsating rhythm. While various parts of the hand or an arm may be involved in the motion, the end result is a movement of the fingertip bringing about a slight change in vibrating string's length, which causes an undulation in pitch, Some violinists oscillate backwards or lower in pitch from the actual note when using vibrato. Since it is believed that perception favors the highest pitch in varying sound, vibrato does little, if anything, to disguise an out-of-tune note. In other words, misapplied vibrato is a poor substitute for good intonation. Scales and other exercises meant to work on intonations are typically played without vibrato to make the work easier and more effective. Music students are often taught that unless otherwise marked in music, vibrato is assumed. However, it has to be noted that this is only a trend. There is nothing on sheet music that compels violinists to add vibrato. This can be an obstacle to a classically trained violinist wishing to play in a style that uses little or no vibrato at all, such as Baroque music played in period style and many traditional fiddling styles. Vibrato can be produced by a proper combination of fingers, wrist, and arm motion. One method called hand vibrato involves rocking the hand back at the wrist to achieve oscillation, while another method, arm vibrato, modulates the pitch by rocking at the elbow. A combination of these techniques allows a player to produce a large variety of tonal effects. The when and what, for and how much of violin vibrato are artistic matters of style and taste. Different teachers, music schools and styles of music favor different vibrato style. For example, overdone vibrato may become distracting. In acoustic terms, the interest that vibrato adds to the sound has to do with the best way that the overtone mix or tone color or timbre and the directional pattern of sound projection change with changes in pitch. By pointing the sound at different parts of the room in a rhythmic way, vibrato adds a shimmer or liveliness to the sound of a well-made violin. Vibrato is in a large part left to the discretion of the violinist. Different types of vibrato will bring different moods to a piece, and the varying degree and styles of vibrato are often characteristic and stand out in well-known violinists. Vibrato trill. A vibrato-like motion can sometimes be used to create a fast trill effect. To execute this effect, the finger above the finger stopping the note is placed very slightly off the string, firmly pressed against the finger stopping the string, and a vibrato motion is implemented. The second finger will lightly touch the string above the lower finger, with each oscillation causing the pitch to oscillate in a fashion that sounds like a mix between wide vibrato and a very fast trill. This gives a less defined transition between the higher and lower note and is usually implemented by interpretative choice. This trill technique only works well for semitonal trills or trills in high positions where the distance between notes is lessened, as it requires the trilling finger and the finger below it to be touching, limiting the distance that can be trilled. In very high position where the trilled distance is less than the width of the finger, a vibrato trill may be the only option for trill effects. Now let's talk about the harmonics. Lightly touching the string with the fingertip at a harmonic mode, but without fully pressing the string and then plucking or bowing the string, creates harmonics. Instead of a normal tone, a higher pitched note sounds. Each note is at higher integer division of the string, for example, halfway or one-third along the length of the string. A responsive instrument will sound numerous possible harmonic notes along the length of the string. Harmonics are marked in music either with little circles above the note that determines the pitch of the harmonic, or by diamond-shaped notes heads. There are two types of harmonics: natural harmonic and artificial harmonics, also known as false harmonics. Natural harmonics are played on an open string. The pitch of the open string when it is plucked or bowed is called the fundamental frequency. Harmonics are also called overtones or partials. They occur at a whole number multiple of fundamental, which is called the first harmonic. The second harmonic is the first overtone, the octave above the open string. The third harmonic is the second overtone, and so on. The second harmonic is in the middle of the string that sound an octave higher than the string's pitch. The third harmonic breaks the string into thirds and sounds an octave and a fifth above the fundamental, and the fourth harmonic breaks the string into quarters sounding two octaves above the first. The sound of the second harmonic is the clearest of them all because it is a common node with all the succeeding even numbered harmonics, 4th, 6th, etc. The third and succeeding odd number harmonics are harder to play because they break the string into an odd number of vibrating parts and do not share as many notes with the other harmonics. Artificial harmonics are more difficult to produce than natural harmonics as they involve both stopping the string and playing a harmonic on the stopped note. Using the octave frame, the normal distance between the first and fourth finger in any given position, with the fourth finger just touching the string a fourth higher than the stopped note, produces the fourth harmonic. Two octaves above the note, fingers placement and pressure, as well as bow speed, pressure and sounding point are all essential in getting the desired harmonic to sound. And to add to the challenge, in passages with different notes played as false harmonics, the distance between stopping finger and harmonic finger must constantly change since the spacing between notes changes along the length of the string. The harmonic finger can also touch at a major third above the pressed note, the fifth harmonic, or a fifth higher, a third harmonic. These harmonics are less commonly used. In the case of the major third, both the stop note and touch note must be played slightly sharp, otherwise the harmonic does not speak as readily. In the case of the fifth, the stretch is greater than is comfortable for many violinists. In the general repertoire, fractions smaller than a sixth are not used. However, divisions up to an eighth are sometimes used, and given a good instrument and skilled player, divisions as small as the 12th are possible. There are a few books dedicated solely to the study of violin harmonics. Two comprehensive works are Hendrik Heller's 7-volume theory of harmonics, published by Simrock in 1928, and Michelangelo Abbado's 5-volume Tecnica dei Suoni Armonici, published by Ricordi in 1934. Elaborate passages in artificial harmonics can be found in virtuoso violin literature, especially of the 19th and early 20th centuries. Two notable examples of these are the entire section of Vittorio Monti's Sardras and a passage towards the middle of the third movement of Piotr Ilich Tchaikovsky's Violin Concerto, a section of the third movement of Paganini's Violin Concerto No. 1 consists of double stop thirds in harmonics. When strings are worn, dirty and old, the harmonics may no longer be accurate in pitch. For this reason, violinists change their strings regularly. Well, that was the left hand. Now let's see the right hand and its tone color. The strings may be sounded by drawing the hair of the bow held by the right hand across them, arco, or by plucking them, pizzicato, most often with the right hand. In some cases, the violinist will pluck strings with the left hand. This is done to facilitate transitions from pizzicato to arco playing. It is also used in some virtuoso showpieces. Left hand pizzicato is usually done on open strings. Pizzicato is used on all of the violin family instruments. However, the systematic study of advanced pizzicato techniques is most developed in jazz bass, a style in which the instrument is almost exclusively plucked. The right arm, hand and bow and the bow speed are responsible for tone quality, rhythm, dynamics, articulation and most but not all changes in timbre. The player draws the bow over the string, causing the string to vibrate and produce a sustained tone. The bow is wooden stick with tensioned horsetail hair, which has been rosined with bar of rosin. The natural texture of the horsehair and the stickiness of the rosin help the bow to grip the string, and thus when the bow is drawn over the string, the bow causes the string to sound a pitch. Bowing can be used to produce long sustained notes or melodies. With a string section, If the players in a section change their bows at a different times, a note can seem to be endlessly sustainable. As well, the bow can be used to play short, crisp little notes such as repeated notes, scales and arcs, which provide a propulsive rhythm in many styles of music. Now let's see some bowing techniques. The most essential part of bowing technique is the bow grip. It is usually with the thumb bent in a small area between the frog and winding of the bow. The other fingers are spread somewhat evenly across the top part of the bow. The pinky finger is curled with a tip of the finger placed on the wood next to the screw. The violin produces louder notes with greater bow speed or more weight on the string. The two methods are not equivalent because they produce different timbres. Pressing down on the string tends to produce a harsher, more intense sound. One can also achieve a louder sound by placing the bow closer to the bridge. The sounding point where the bow intersects the string also influences timbre or tone color. Playing close to the bridge, sul ponticello, give a more intense sound than usual, emphasizing the higher harmonics, and playing with the bow over the end of the fingerboard, soltasto, makes for a delicate ethereal sound, emphasizing the fundamental frequency. Dr. Suzuki referred to the sounding point as the Chrysler Highway. One may think of different sounding points as lanes in the highway. Various methods of attack with the bow produce different articulations. There are many bowing techniques that allow for every range of playing style, and many teachers, players, and orchestras spend a lot of time developing the techniques and creating a unified technique within the group. These techniques include legato style bowing, a smooth, connected, sustained sound suitable for melodies, qali, and a variety of bowing which produce shorter notes including ricochet, sautille, martel, spiccato, and staccato. Pizzicato. A note marked piz, abbreviation for pizzicato, in the written music is to be played by plucking the string with a finger of the right hand rather by bowing. The index finger is most commonly used here. Sometimes in orchestra parts or virtuoso solo music where the bow hand is occupied or for show of effect. Left hand pizzicato will be indicated by a plus sign below or above the note. In the left hand pizzicato, two fingers are put on string. One, usually the index or middle finger, is put on the correct note, and the other, usually the ring finger or little finger, is put above the note. The higher finger then plucks the string while the lower one stays on, thus producing the correct pitch. By increasing the force of the pluck, one can increase the volume of the note that the string is producing. Pizzicato is used in orchestral works and in solo showpiece. In orchestral parts, violinists often have to make very quick shifts from arco to pizzicato and vice versa. Now let's see collegno. A marking of collegno, Italian for the with the wood, in the written music calls for striking the strings with the stick of the bow rather than by drawing the hair of the bow across the strings. This bowing technique is somewhat rarely used and results in a muted percussive sound. The eerie quality of a violin section playing collegno is exploited in some symphonic pieces, notably the Witch's Dance of the last movement of Berlioz's Symphonie Fantastique. Saint-Saëns' symphonic poem Danse Macabre includes the string section using the collegno technique to imitate the sound of dancing skeletons. Mars from Gustav Holst. The planets use collegno to play a repeated rhythm in 54-time signature. Benjamin Britten's The Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra demands its use in the percussion variation. Dmitri Shostakovich uses it in his 14th symphony in the movement at the St. Gilles. Some violinists, however, object to this style of playing as it can damage the finish and impair the value of a fine bow, but most of such will compromise by using a cheap bow for at least the duration of the passage in question. Detach. A smooth and even stroke during which bow speed and weight are the same from beginning of the stroke to the end. Martel. Literally, hammered, a strong accented effect. produced by releasing each bow stroke forcefully and suddenly. Martel can be played in any part of the bow. It is sometimes indicated in written music by an arrowhead. Tremolo. It is the very rapid repetition, typically of a single note but occasionally of multiple notes, usually played at the tip of the bow. Tremolo is marked with the three short slanted lines across the stem of the note. Tremolo is used as a sound effect in orchestral music, particularly in Romantic music era, that is 1800s to 1910, and in opera music. Mute or sordino. Attaching a small metal, rubber, leather or wooden device called a mute or sordino to the bridge of the violin gives a softer, more mellow tone with fewer audible overtones. The sound of an entire orchestral string section playing with mutes has a hushed quality. The mute changes both the loudness and the timbre, tone color of a violin. The conventional Italian markings for mute usage are consort or consordino, meaning with mute, and senza sord, meaning without mute, or via sord, meaning mute off. Well, that was the playing techniques. We hope you have understood today's concept. If you have any queries, then feel free to contact us. You will find the contact details down in the description. If you have liked today's video, then don't forget to drop a like to it and share it with your family and friends so that even they get to learn the playing techniques of a violin. Tune in with us in the upcoming video of the fifth part of the violin introduction. To be notified when we upload the next video, you should go and hit the subscribe button and push the bell icon. You can follow us over Facebook and Instagram for more updates. Links are in the description. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you in the next video very soon. Till then, you can watch the rest of the videos which are going to appear right now here on the screen. Enjoy!